So Sam, thanks for joining us today. How you been doing?
Yeah, really good, thanks. Yeah, it's good to be on the show. Yeah, good to be here. How
Well,
are you?
it's been a long time since we've talked properly. In fact, it's been years and years and years. So I don't even know what you've been up to lately. Do you still live in Bristol?
No, I'm in Spain now.
Oh, wow.
Been here for a few years and really loving it. Yeah, come back now and then, but this is home. So, yeah.
So I want our listeners to know we're going to be talking about EFT and probably various healing techniques, but how come you moved to Spain?
We were in a position in Bristol where we thought we were in a long-term house, basically, and then suddenly our landlord needed his house back because he lost his job in America. So it was one of those unexpected things. And I was like, okay, well, let's move to another part of Bristol. And my wife, Star, said, no, let's try something else. And we went, let's have a look at Spain. And yeah, we met some people at a health fair in Bristol. And they came from this place called Orcova, which is where we are now. And we thought, let's try that place out. And then we got here and it was just completely awesome. Really interesting place, beautiful scenery, so much going for it. And so we moved here. And since we got here, it's just been even better. It's got a really interesting community of all sorts of weird and wonderful people in a close to a really like friendly, enjoyable Spanish market town. Very friendly people here, and yeah, just really fit all the boxes for us. So we
And
stuck around.
is it what's it like being an English person in Spain? I mean, is the community that you've found, is it full of English people, or how does that work in terms of language and stuff?
It's pretty mixed here. It's a some people think of it as a bit like a weird sort of interzone place, really. There's 60 nationalities in this small area, so that's pretty. Three quarters of the people here are Spanish. Then you've got quite a number of English people. Then a lot of other Europeans, but there's people from all over the world, and it really pays to learn Spanish here, rather than be in your English bubble.
Oh,
So
right.
I
So
was
you
already
have.
okay at Spanish, but I'm picking up more and more as the years go by. So,
Oh, I see. Right. So it's worth learning Spanish then, basically.
well, unless you want to play bowls all the time and yeah, or just be yeah, in your ever decreasing circle. Yeah, it's good to yeah, because yeah, the people here are friendly, they're a good laugh and very interesting, so it's a good to be involved.
What's
Yeah,
the alternative community? The community. I mean, presumably you've found people because you're into healing and stuff. So, like, what's the scene like there?
it well, there's all sorts of people here, so you could almost see it as a kind of microcosm of, I guess, Bristol, really, the types of people you get. There are there's definitely lots of alternative holistic people here, and there's also lots of hedonism and really good parties and stuff like that. Loads of circus stuff, which I know you've been interested in as well.
Right.
So there's a lot of that sort of thing going on. And one thing that I really like about it is that if people want to do something here, they just get on and do it. So no waiting around to be told that they can. They just get on with it,
Now,
which is quite refreshing.
is that just a cultural attitude, or is that to do with like the government and licensing and regulation, like which, or is it both?
Well, government and licensing is a funny thing here because in Spain has quite an authoritarian government, but they're very weak in terms of their hold on the people. So Spain's really a lot looser than the UK. Spain, it's called Spain, but all the different regions are fairly autonomous, so things happen far more at a local level than being nationally controlled. There's of course the government attempts to do that, but out when you're in a sort of market town out in the mountains, most people don't pay a lot of notice to that beyond the minimum they have to. So it's quite refreshing in that way.
Oh, I see. So there's more freedom in a sense.
It certainly feels that way. And the local authorities, I think the sort of the smaller you make the decision-making requirements, the better, the closer it is to individual freedom.
Right.
And it fits in. Yeah, and that's been a really nice thing about this. Now, we're not currently property owners here, but I know from people who are that, you know, if a small dirt road wants a water supply dug in, they just dig it in rather than waiting for years and years and years to get things done.
Right.
So now you know, of course they have got regulations and legislation and people do fall foul of it, but there's just much, it's a bit more sensible than having to wait to be told for everything.
Yeah. What's it like in terms of cost of living compared to England?
Probably, when we first came out here, and when we came for our recce, it was awesome because you were getting about 1.4 euros to the pound, and things are cheap anyway. So that was a really good way of looking at things. Since all the Brexit fear-mongering and everything's happened, you've got the pound at 110 or whatever. It's a bit more, but still. So some examples are, if you want a nice house with a swimming pool and a nice view, is about 600 euros. That's about 500 quid a month rental. So that's certainly excellent value.
Right.
And a beer in a bar is about 2 euros, and you get a bit of food with it as well. You get tapas as well. So you can go out with 10 euros and have a meal and plenty of drinks if you want to. So,
all right, that's a lot cheaper then, isn't it?
It's really cheap in that way. But then there's other things that are more expensive. So my internet is, to get decent internet here, it's 50 euros a month.
Hmm.
So it's various, there's ups and downs, but I guess overall it's probably 80% or 75-80% of the cost of the UK.
Right. Well, that sounds great. And you've got when I first met you, you just had your baby, but is there more than one now?
Yeah, we've got another baby at the moment. Yeah. So right. we've got a girl who's just gone one.
Right.
So
lovely. Yeah. That's great.
Which is great.
So and also when I first met you, you were involved, I think you were a financial advisor or something, and you were sort of beginning to do EFT. So what's the situation with that now? Is EFT now your primary thing or what?
Yeah, it's evolved beyond that. So I still love tapping techniques and I use them with everyone I work with. But the main thing that I do is I support people to understand the reasons why their body has got health symptoms going on. So if they've got, for example, eczema or something like that, then, and they've not been having success in having it treated through whatever other methods they've tried, then I can help them to understand what the body's trying to do with the symptom. And then once they've got the knowledge, then they can use whatever sort of treatment, therapy or whatever to support them, including mainstream medicine if that's the right route for them, or part of their things. So it's integrated health coaching using a model called Meta Health.
So is this more on the psychology and emotional side of things, or is it a nutritional side of things?
Yes, well, it's showing if the body is intelligent, why it's responding in this way, why it's putting particular symptoms for your attention, basically.
Okay.
If you had specific situations in your life or emotional events or themes or beliefs that aren't in line with you, then different body tissues can flare up in different ways, exhibit various different symptoms. It can also be mental health stuff. So different behavior patterns can arise as part of you actually trying to resolve something that you couldn't resolve at the time.
Okay, so give us an example then.
Example, okay. So a couple of examples that I think are quite clear and really interesting. One of them is eczema. So if someone has eczema, that's on the outer layer of their skin. And the skin is really your interface with the outside world, with touch and all of that. So if you've got eczema in particular parts of your body, it represents a stage of a separation conflict. So if you think about eczema on your inner arms, that might be a separation conflict from touch of hugging somebody. So metaphorically having some form of separation. But it's not quite as simple as that, because the eczema actually comes up when you've had some sort of acceptance about the situation. And it's actually, although it's the painful, nasty bit that everyone thinks is the condition itself, it's actually you've released the stress around the separation in some way, and the eczema is actually the healing going on. So it's when your body's regenerating is when you get all the flare up and the tissues changing.
Oh, I see. So it could represent either. It could represent the fact that it's clearing and healing, or it could represent the fact that it's, how do you say it? The current state, kind of thing.
Well, if it's the current state, in the case of eczema, you don't normally notice it, but what you are is you might be stressed, or you might be obsessively thinking about whatever the situation is. And it's when you get some sort of resolution, but not a full resolution, the regeneration symptoms, when the body's endeavouring to heal.
Right.
Basically.
Okay, yeah, I think I'm with you. Yeah, keep going.
So so you have the stress part, which comes after. So if something happens, it's a shocking event where you feel isolated and unable to deal with it at the time, even subconsciously, or it's a trigger that's reminded you of something like that in your past, then you go into a stress phase where your body creates lots of hormones like adrenaline, cortisol, those sorts of things. You're obsessively thinking about whatever the problem is, trying to solve it. Your body is, whatever your body's doing, sometimes it's noticeable symptoms, but most of the time in the first phase, you don't really notice so much going on in the body, because the body tissues tend to be shrinking at this stage in quite a lot of the visible sort of symptoms. So in the case of the eczema, skin is thinning in when you are missing somebody or whatever the separation is. And separations don't always have to be about missing someone. It can be that you want to be away from something. So if it's on, for example, if it's on your back, it might be you're trying to get away from something. Basically, if it's on the sort of what you might call the inner bit of your body, so hugging the front of your body, your face, etc., it's for missing something. And if it's on the outer bit, the more defensive part of your body, like elbows, knees, your back, something like that, then it's more about trying to get away from something. But during that stressful time, the skin's thinning in that time, basically. And it's when you have the acceptance, make peace with it, whatever, then the physical symptoms happen, the swelling, the heat, which is the tissue repairing itself. And at the same time, people tend to feel a bit more down, because it's when your body's trying to get you back in the cave, back into bed, to relax and regenerate.
Right.
Another one that I think is really interesting is prostate growth, and in men.
Yeah.
And which normally happens to men who are around in their, well, midlife or later is when it's generally happening. And what it tends to represent is when people have had a loss of status compared, and it's often they perceive it as it's due to their age. So an example might be someone who's been the top salesman at a company for 20 years or whatever, and suddenly he's a bit out of touch, or the young bucks are rising up to to beat him, he started losing his place in the tribe, or his status and his in terms of nature, his ability to attract a mate and have more offspring, because he's starting to be overcome by the young stags and the young bucks in the company. So the prostate swelling up is actually to be able to produce more, again, back in nature, to produce more musk to attract more females. Right. So it's all very based on the fact that we are natural animals, but we're no longer living in a natural way. And the domestication is causing us to have all these problems in our lives.
I see. Yeah. Is there any other sort of obvious examples that are easy to give us?
Another one is a cold.
Yeah.
So something that happens a lot is that you get people who are working their ass off and they're stress, thinking about work all the time, got to get their project done or whatever, and they have to go, well, they don't have to, but they've got a holiday booked. Or as it is now, it's coming up to Christmas and they're going to have a break. What often happens is as the break starts, then they get a cold. And they relax, the symptoms take over, and the first few days of their holiday, they go into this full regeneration mode, and they have to, they miss out on the first bit of the fun because their body's just, they're not thinking about the stressful thing anymore. They've gone into regeneration, cold symptoms happen. Now, normally colds, of course, they can make a full recovery very quickly, and that often happens. But it's when people get stuck in a loop of not actually completing the healing cycle is when there might be something that needs to be done to get them out of it.
So what about nutritional allergies with regards to skin and eczema and stuff? What part does that play in the context of, like, the psychological, emotional side of things?
Yeah, totally. So you can have, we view an allergy as very similar to a phobia. So it is basically the body having a reaction and a response to a substance. The difference is that the substance with an allergy has already gone inside your body in some way or touched your body in some way, whereas with a phobia, you've probably reacted quick enough to get it away from you as quickly as possible, like a spider or something like that. But let's say it's a pollen. So if we're thinking of pollen in hay fever or something like that, it's if someone has hay fever going on, when the symptoms happen, then what you're looking at is when they actually developed this allergy, what was going on in their life at the time, which caused the symptoms, which their body is then associating with the fact that there was also a particular kind of pollen in their system.
So the pollen you're saying is not the cause, but it's like an anchor that's re-triggering a reaction.
Yeah, it is. It's exactly that. It's an anchor that is holding the reaction in place. Just because people are bound to think, well, yeah, but I was born with this or something like that, then these things can be passed on epigenetically as well.
So you're saying an emotional trauma is the actual real root cause?
Yeah. An emotional trauma or a theme in life or a belief system that was, and normally it's all of those, that was triggered at a certain time. And it could have actually been instigated in a parent or grandparent's life, but being triggered in you through the epigenetic process when something happened, either in utero or in early life, or as a lot of people get allergies later on in life as well. They're not all present from the beginning. So,
and what it's basically, what do you call this method again? I can't remember what you said.
This is MetaHealth.
MetaHealth. Okay.
It's not a therapy in its own right. It's more of a way of analysing what's going on.
Hey, there's a name, there's a guy, Richard Moat. Is it anything to do with him?
Richard
Moat.
Moat. I don't know the name.
The only reason I mention it is years ago, I remember going to some seminar or some talk, and he was talking. It was a very similar kind of thing. And I'm pretty sure it was mental health or something like that. And I just wonder if it's the same
school. There is a guy called Richard who was very involved. And he was in Bristol, so you might well have seen him there.
Okay.
I'm just trying to remember his second name. Because when you said Richard, it sounded... I was just looking to see if I had his book up here, but no. I don't, yeah.
Not to worry, it seems like...
You might well have seen him in Bristol, because he was talking about this stuff 10 years ago, or whatever.
Mm. Okay, yeah, I'd be interested to know if it is the same guy. And so... So given that emotional trauma is the root cause of stuff, what do you do about it with your method then?
So basically once you understand the belief, the specific events that have led to it and the theme in life, then there's a number of things that you can do. And the classic one is to go back and resolve the traumas and change the beliefs with whatever method you know and whatever method you use. I use tapping techniques like EFT, matrix reimprinting. And I also like using a lot of humor in sessions as well. So I find that things resolve very quickly if people are able to find something light about them. After they've resolved the very heavy stuff, of course. But that's not enough, because let's say you are 40 and you have been experiencing something since you were 3 years old. We've had 37 years to build a habit as well.
Yeah.
So you also, I think what's really important is actually changing the pattern now. So if it's to do with isolation, then... just releasing the stuff about isolation in the past is helpful, but you really need to do something about it now as well. So whatever that means to you, whether it is actually entering into more of a accepting relationship of yourself, or if it's isolation from the community, then going out and finding meaningful things that you want to do with other people, which again could be anything from going to the pub through to going to whatever exercise classes really fit in with your values and the things that you like doing. So
I see. So you've got to replace
to each person.
So that the old patterns have to be replaced with something new, as opposed to just kind of dealing with what happened.
Yeah. Cause if you think of smoking, for example, You can resolve the old reasons why someone might have taken up smoking, whatever they were, but they've still built up a very strong field around this habit of just reaching for a cigarette.
Mm.
And if you don't then put something in place to break that, whether it is using a technique to consciously break the habit, or finding something to replace it, then that, you know, you need to have something that's for the now and the future as well as for the past.
I see. Oh, right. So you approach it with a problem solving kind of, like you might help someone in a variety of different ways. You might use EFT, NLP, a bit of coaching, a bit of counseling, a bit of humor. It could be a multi-varied approach.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't been very funny on this interview, but normally I'm better than this. So.
yeah, I see what you mean. That makes sense. That makes sense.
And you mentioned nutrition before as well, so I just want to say that is important too, because the body is rebuilding itself all the time. So whatever you put in is going to come out in the way your body rebuilds and repairs itself.
Mm. Sometimes it's tricky. It's always difficult. What am I trying to say? I think nowadays I'm a bit more of a rational skeptic. I think sort of 10 years ago, I was more open-minded and more accepting without questioning or scrutinizing ideas. And now I'm a little bit more in the middle. I think, you know, I try and think of the other side.
It's
tricky sometimes because a lot of things are kind of like an art. They're tricky or unviable to measure and test and verify and conduct studies on, aren't there? Because there might be a lot of sort of variables at play. And so what am I trying to say? What makes you so sure that
prove
this
it's
works?
Not bullshit. Yeah.
Yeah. So. Well, essentially.
So MetaHealth's got a strong background. It has come from something called German New Medicine, which has been around since the 80s and had loads of empirical studies done into it. So I know empirical doesn't fulfill the needs of the pharmaceutical industry's double blind tests or whatever, but they are, they're very real studies that have happened and shown that people did get good results from it. It also does, it fits in very well with embryology and how the body actually develops, because different body tissues and the things that trigger them fit in exactly with the stages of development that an embryo goes through from an early stage. So as different tissues are laid down, they've got different meanings. From pure survival, which is the core organs, through attack, integrity and protection, which is there's sort of a next level of organs, through to structure and stability, which is the muscles and bones, and that's your ability to kind of affect the world. So self-esteem, self-value often is reflected in musculoskeletal pain, for example, and then through to the social stuff, which is going on with the last layer, which is the skin. So it works very well with biology, and it does make sense to doctors when you talk to them about it, some of them.
So depending what part of the body is experiencing the issue, that gives you an indication of what stage of development that something traumatic might have happened. Is that what you mean?
Each layer of tissues is associated with a different brain layer. So the deepest survival stuff, which is basically, my trainer Penny says, eating, shagging and pooing, goes on with is stuff that's going on in the brain stem, the most primal brain tissue. Right. Then you've got attack and protection and integrity, which is going on in the cerebellum, which is more emotional stuff. Then you've got these all develop as an embryo begins. They've just got the brain stem, then the cerebellum develops, then the cerebral medulla, which is the next layer, which is associated with the muscles and skeleton, then the cerebral cortex, which is like the higher brain and everything and to do with social function, is with the skin and other outer parts of the organism largely.
Right. Yeah, but how do you apply that? How is that relevant to your method? Like,
So every part of the body, every body tissue is mapped, and we understand which types of trauma relate to them and what the emotions might be around that. And it's also can be seen on CT scans. So if someone's got a particular issue and they get a CT scan, and you can see rings in different brain tissues. And this is done a lot in Germany, where CT scans are very common and they don't cost the same as they do in the UK. So this was sort of the evidence that they built up in German New Medicine. And what it also showed is that during the stress phase, when people are trying to still resolve the trauma, the rings, the like a sort of donut style ring in that particular part of the brain that relates to the body tissue was very pronounced. But when it's been resolved, then although you can still see, you can sort of see an echo of where the ring was, but the tissue is repaired. So it's like there's a scar there relating to the tissue.
Right. So after, let's say after you've done this process with someone and they've healed, you can measure it before and after, because there's measurable stress in the brain that's detectable somehow.
Yeah, basically. And hopefully you can measure it by the fact that the symptoms have released as well.
Yeah.
Which
right.
is kind of the point. Yeah. But it's not just about getting better in as getting over the illness. It's actually within the seeds of within whatever the symptom is, there's seeds of how someone is not living their life in a way that's true to them as well. So it might be showing them that they are isolated, and they can resolve it by actually taking action to get back into the tribe or go forwards into a community that's more in line with what they want in their life. Or might be showing them that they hate their job or something like that.
Right. So I see. So that's where they might need new lifestyle habits to. So it's not just a case of fixing the problem. It's sort of making sure that the same lifestyle habits don't sort of bring it back, kind of thing.
Yeah, they're not just going back to more of the same, effectively.
I see. Yeah. Now I realise. Oh yeah. Go on. Sorry.
That's just what in terms of the other one, because I started with and is still a major part of what I do with EFT. Tapping and the other techniques around that is now, although it did start out well in the realms of the woo, it has been, there's been a huge amount of research done in it over the last 10 years or whatever, to the point that it's now been actually taken on in the latest NICE guidelines, which is the NHS guidelines.
Oh, really?
And
really?
For something like that to happen, that's pretty significant. I mean, I don't pay much attention to government and thing what they say. Generally I would look to the opposite side of what the government suggests, but this is almost the irrefutable. It's been so effective, and so many psychologists, counselors, etc. are now using it, getting good results with clients, and they've backed it up with studies in loads of different areas, that it's really looking like it's going to actually massively snowball.
Okay.
And there's loads of evidence to back that up as well.
Now, give us some explanation of how EFT works, because I've got a very rough idea, but I don't really know. So how do you explain it?
Well, basically, it's tapping on a simple map of acupuncture points around the body, and you can learn that in 10 minutes on YouTube. You can learn quite a lot of it in watching YouTube videos, in fact, dealing with day-to-day stuff. But what it's actually doing is it enables you to go really deep into old stuff and find, basically neutralize the emotional attachment to old events, which is why it works so well once you know the root cause for mental health to really release those things. And so they just become stories. The thing I like about it, go on.
Oh, no, I was going to say, by tapping, here's my understanding of it. You sort of think of a memory or something that has a certain association for you, and then by tapping on these points on your nervous system, it kind of disrupts or scrambles, the neuro connections, and it kind of scrambles the negative memory or something like that. Is that what it is?
Yeah, it works a lot like that. But what you're really doing, you're not just thinking about it, you're really feeling what you felt at the time. So you're releasing feelings that you sort of stuffed down at the time so you could keep operating, but they're still now colouring the way your subconscious operates in the world and causes you to act without you even really being aware of it some of the time. Or perhaps you become aware, but you can't break the pattern.
That's it's very tricky for us to think that there's unconscious stuff that's in our blind spot that we're acting on that we're not aware of, isn't it? I mean, that it's hard to wrap your mind around, isn't it? And it's
controlling everything. Yeah,
but... yeah. There's something a little scary about that, isn't there? To think that we're playing out things, that we're unaware.
Imagine if you had to think, breathe in, breathe out all day. So it's your automated programs, and you even see it in driving, don't you? When you first start driving, you're super conscious of it, your everything is a conscious move, and gradually moving the pedals, using the brakes, whatever, becomes very subconscious. So it becomes automated. Hopefully your total driving process doesn't become totally automated. wouldn't be great, but...
I think it's really fun and really helpful to hear, you know, examples of this stuff. So is the, I know you can't say names or anything because of client confidentiality, but is there any particular scenarios or any particular clients that stand out in your mind? Like, you know.
Yeah, loads. I've got loads. I'll just tell you some who've given me written and video testimonials.
Okay.
So yeah, one I had, someone came to me and she was really massively, this was quite a few years ago, massively depressed, had huge grief issues, lost both her parents, and had had a bad relationship with them as well. And she was actually over, we did six sessions, which is a good amount to start with, because, I mean, people want everything done in one session, but that's just not realistic. You might deal with some surface stuff, but generally you want to really build on things and not just have a superficial outcome. But she ended up quitting her job, becoming self-employed, and yeah, very successfully traveling and English teaching for a while, and then ended up after that doing something that she really loved. So that was one.
So that was more like an emotional unhappiness as opposed to like a physical illness, was it?
Oh yeah, these are things from a while ago that I'm talking about. And I use mental health now a lot with I think depression is a massive one. And that's just, yeah, people just being fed up with the way their lives are to the point that they've gone numb. Well, there's loads of different ways that it can manifest, but yeah, just not enjoying life, gone very numb to the world, not feeling anything other than feeling shit when they think about this stuff, or just realize that they're totally basically out of sync with who they are. And it's really good for exploring that. But physical ones, so yeah, I've had really really good successes with eczema, and yeah, someone who had in first session I had with him, his skin was, and again, you've only got my word for this, it's because it sounds like bullshit, but he's had red, angry, hot skin. And in the session, you could actually, although the lump still remained on his skin, it changed colour. So it went pink, softer. And so that in its own right was great, because he then had a technique he could use to calm down the heat and the itching and everything that was going on. And even that, for some people's enough. They don't necessarily then want to go do the deep stuff, but he did. And we ended up, we found a root cause, real separation issue from family at a very early age. And we were able to, and it, again, this was due to a situation that should never happened with, unfortunately, yeah, a mum who had mental health issues and had caused particular, yeah, and had, yeah, done something. I don't really want to go into much more detail than that, but it was a pretty unpleasant thing. And then, yeah, but then after that, gradually over time, after four sessions, he was probably 90% of the eczema was gone. And then when I saw him again a year or two later, it hadn't come back at all and it was completely gone. I've got loads of them. So
what does mental health have to say about life-threatening stuff like cancer, more serious illnesses?
So yeah, cancer is of course a very interesting one. And like, as with any symptom that the body creates, that happens in the body, mental health shows that there's a meaning for it. And so with a cancer, if there's a tumor growth, depends whether it is which part of the body it's in. So certain body parts, the tumor grows during the stress phase, and certain other body parts, it grows in the regeneration phase. So firstly, you need to know which part of the body it is, and then you can tell the client whether it's actually in stress or it's in regeneration. One thing that's really key is that each body part is seen as having a particular meaning. So what we definitely don't see is that cancer spreads.
How
so it's
do,
a very very different way of perceiving it than the mainstream.
I don't quite understand what you mean. What do you mean?
Well, some people will get a cancer diagnosis, breast cancer or whatever, and then they'll go and they'll get tested, they'll get fully scanned, and they'll say, oh, it's also in your bones, it's in your liver as well. And then they say, oh, it's the same thing, but it's not the same thing. There's never been evidence of cancer actually traveling through the blood.
Right.
So it's actually a separate thing happening. And so just in that regard, what we'd say is that the shock of the diagnosis actually can trigger certain situations as well. So if you get a breast cancer diagnosis, cancer's got a reputation in our society, hasn't it?
Mm.
That it's deadly, it is it's scary, it's a difficult thing, and so when people hear it, then that in itself is a shocking emotional moment at the time, and that could then trigger one of the core survival organs, such as the liver or the lungs.
Mm.
And then these would then be picked up in a medical way as a secondary cancer.
Right.
But we see them as they're separate things, and they need to be treated. Right? And then you need to, so really key part of working with cancer. And by the way, and you know, most people, it's not a case of do this or do the medical route. A lot of people do both. A lot of people do the chemotherapy as well, or the radiotherapy, as well as supporting themselves with nutrition, using various supplements to keep their immune system up, which is a real problem, because things like chemotherapy, radiotherapy will knock all the white blood cells out and leave people very subject to infection often. But if they're doing chemotherapy and they really believe it's part of their process, as well as actually resolving the emotional stuff and the potential root causes, and really key their beliefs about what cancer is and what it means for them, then they've got there's been many stories of people actually healing themselves from cancer.
I see. So if they follow the advice of the doctor, there's nothing to lose by them also dealing with the psychological side of things as well. There's nothing to lose, really.
Yeah, definitely not. There's everything to gain, I would say, because, I mean, stress is well known, but that's having bad effects on the body if you maintain stress for a long time.
Mm.
So I
think critics of alternative healing, one of the criticisms is that if people think that an alternative method is going to heal them and is ineffective, then they might not seek, you know, conventional help from a doctor, kind of thing. And that overall could end up causing them more harm. So what do you say to that? Because I feel like it's sort of a tricky position to be in, isn't it, with these conversations? Because I'm not really sure... With this kind of stuff, you've got to be very responsible, haven't you, with sort of the way you phrase things. You've got to be careful how you phrase things. And, you know, even as a podcast host, I feel kind of self-conscious about the way you phrase stuff.
Yeah, no, me too, talking about cancer, of course, because it's such an issue.
Mm.
And so the first thing I'll say on that is that actually I'm not doing any healing. It's all the healing is down to themselves and their body healing itself. So all healing, self-healing, and anyone who tells you that they heal you is not really, you've got to be very careful about any of that sort of thing.
Yeah. I mean, even if it's true, like even if it works, even if it's true, even just purely from like a legal standpoint, there's like a, you still got to be careful just how you...
The 1933 Cancer Act in the UK.
Yeah.
1939 or something. It's very, very limiting on what you can do. Other countries are a lot freer on what you can do about cancer. For example, in Japan, they use medicinal mushrooms a lot with chemotherapy alongside it, which really helps support the immune system for people. Germany, there's a lot more flexibility in what people can do. But the real key thing is always, number one, with mental health and what I do, doctor first. We won't do it without a medical analysis. They need to have had a diagnosis. Yeah, because I can't diagnose what's actually going on with someone. Mm. I mean, if it's very obvious that they've got eczema, then... But even then, I don't know if it's actually eczema, if it's psoriasis or whatever. So they have to get a medical diagnosis first. And also, we don't work... It's not this or that. It's this as well as that, if people want to do that.
Oh, I see. So you don't discourage people from getting conventional
help? No, definitely not. Yeah. I think it's really important. Because that... There's a lot of life-saving medical advances that have happened. You know, millions and millions of people have had their lives saved through that medicine, or at least extended through that medicine. And if you have a broken arm, a car crash or whatever, I know where I'd rather go.
Mm.
And it's not the back flower remedies expert.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's important to sort of clarify stuff like that, isn't it? Because I can see it from both sides in a way, you know. Okay, so what else?
Well, where are we?
Do you offer this sort of face to face, or do you do it over Skype, or how do you work with people?
I do Zoom, which is similar to Skype.
Okay.
Yeah, which is why I needed a bit of time to set Skype up this evening, because I haven't used it for such a long time.
Okay.
I do it face to face. I also do run some retreats out here for people, which they've been a lot of fun. And most of the people I work with are people who are still in the UK or in America or Australia or English speaking from anywhere. And although I speak Spanish, I wouldn't have a degree to actually be able to help someone with this sort of stuff yet. And I do it all over Zoom.
Wow, that's great. How can people find you?
So they can check out my website, which is eftnow.co.uk, or they can get in touch with me on Facebook, and I'm Sam Neffendorf on there. And I am, of course, I'm happy to have a chat. Happy for people to throw their allegations of me bullshitting and being a quack at me, whatever. So,
do you get a lot of that?
No, not really.
Okay.
It doesn't happen. But maybe I've just invited it in.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying you should or you shouldn't, but yeah, I'm just curious because, you know, I mean, I've certainly had my fair share of flack for various different reasons. And and sometimes when you put yourself out there, sort of publicly anyway, you know, you're a target, aren't you, for criticism. So it's kind of part and parcel, isn't it? I imagine.
If you don't want to live a templated life, then, and you're stepping out of the sort of mainstream view, then of course you're out of people's comfort zones, basically. And if it disrupts their beliefs, and we all know what people will do to hold on to their precious beliefs above anything else, then it does it, of course. But yeah, it's the way it is.
What books would you recommend?
What books would I recommend? I really love books by Bruce Lipton.
Yeah.
Come across his stuff.
Yeah, I think I got halfway through the book, but I've watched quite a lot of his videos.
Yeah. So The Biology of Belief is his main one. Spontaneous Evolution. They're really good. So what else would I recommend in that area? The mental health books are very technical, and they've got a lot of sort of clinical information in them. So they're not necessarily a riveting read, but if people are really interested in them, then the book is the book by Richard Fluke, which I think the guy you were talking about earlier, possibly.
The guy I was on about was Richard Mote, but
Richard Mote, right? Okay.
Yeah, look him up. You might like him actually, because I'm pretty sure it was he works in the same field.
Yeah, I'll definitely definitely check it out.
But Richard Fluke's the one you're talking about, yeah?
Well, he did a he's done a book on mental health, as has Sam Thorpe. So okay. You can check her book out as well. Yeah, but I think that in terms of I like the Bruce Lipton stuff because of his he's very strong on epigenetics and how gives a really good show of how trauma and external events can actually change your DNA and change gene expression. And again, this is all stuff that when he started talking about it was seen as quackery, but now it's very much mainstream science. Still not taught in the schools, of course. It doesn't fit in with the Newtonian model, but it is in all any science journal where we'll be talking about epigenetics relating to biology a lot.
Yeah, right. And outside of this topic, what else is important to you in life? I mean, any other hobbies or what else? I know you're a father, of course, but what else do you enjoy doing?
So, yeah, I love doing outdoor stuff. I'm a big fan of really getting into martial arts at the moment and doing a lot of kickboxing and MMA stuff.
Oh, wicked.
Yeah, which I've just been loving that. Very lucky that there's someone here running that at a pretty good level, and classes are a lot of fun. So do 4 to 5 hours of that a week, most weeks.
Oh, wicked. Do you do BJJ?
Yeah, there's a little bit of that he brings in. He's training in that. He's doing that at a high level. But the main things that we do is a kickboxing style influenced by Bruce Lee, by the Jeet Kune Do, plus also mixed martial arts, so grappling and, yeah, some Thai boxing in there as well. So it's a mixed style. Yeah, just got to a level of sparring in that now. So that's been a lot of fun. And I don't know, I think one of the last times we met, I think you gave me a personal training session, actually, which pretty much killed me.
Oh, yeah, we went to the gym, didn't we? That was a long time ago.
Yeah.
That was some, yeah. I think that was a good 5 years ago, at least.
Yeah, longer, I reckon. Probably yeah. 6 or 7 years ago.
Yeah.
But finally now, because I'm doing this at, a lot of this sort of highly energetic sport is I'm starting to get into what I consider to be pretty good shape. So
fantastic.
Yeah. So that's kind of the main thing I'm doing. There's loads of stuff goes on here as well. As you can find all sorts of funny spiritual stuff going on if you want to go to that. Just being part of the community here. One thing that I have been very interested in is blockchain technology, actually, and watching how that's going. And I've been writing on Steemit. Have you ever come across Steemit?
I've heard of it, but I haven't used it.
It's a good place to additional place to put your podcasts, things like that.
Oh, really?
Not that they stay. You can just load them up onto DSound on the Steem blockchain. I normally do videos on there. I was doing podcasts. I'm going to start some new podcasts up on there as well. And basically you earn cryptocurrency for doing it, which, right. It's transferable. I've taken money off the platform and converted it into money in my bank account. You don't have to pay anything to be involved with it. It's brilliant.
So who's paying? Is it advertisers paying?
Well, it's generated. No, there's no advertising on it currently. They're suggesting that they might get advertising on it, but cryptocurrency actually generated by the platform. So in the same way as, you know, who paid for the Bitcoin when they started out? They generated through code. Well, it's happening on Steem as well. It's the blockchain actually creates its own currency every day, and the value it has is based on what people think having influence on that platform is worth.
So is it like a mining thing where you have to leave the application open and it's processing
it's done in a different way. One of the criticisms of mining, I understand, is that it's very energy, takes a lot of energy. So with steam, it's done in a much more energy efficient way through something called witnessing, which I've not looked into because I'm not running to be a witness on it. I'm more of a content creator. But when I got into it was all about blogging. But gradually there've been more and more apps built on this platform where you can earn currency basically through people's votes. I've never put any money into it, but my vote is worth money for people, and I've built up a certain amount of the currency in my own account. You don't have to get anyone on board, so it's not like an MLM or anything like that. It's just completely, it's almost like a parallel, an opportunity to start a parallel system,
Right.
which you can convert into real money. So there's apps. One example of an app on there, quite interesting, is there's an app on there now that if you do your 10,000 steps a day, so it's called Active Fit, then you get a payment, but you get a payout from it. And they're trying to get this on with Fitbit. So suddenly.
I still don't understand who's paying though. If they're paying out, where's it coming from? I don't get it.
Well, they're paying in an electronic currency, and that just and there didn't have to be, but the value of that currency is based on what people think that actually gets them. So, let's say, so the more of this currency that you've got, and the more of it that you hold on the platform, the more your vote is worth. So you become more influential on
Right.
there. So really the value of the currency initially was influence, but now it's the value of basically, let's say this ActiveFit thing, if that really takes off, then the token that is created by ActiveFit will also have a value in currency as well.
So it's a steam it currency, is it? It steam
It's
it.
called Steam, yeah,
Oh, I see.
STEEM.
And is it the same
Yeah.
as Bitcoin? Like there's a maximum limited supply, so they can't keep expanding it. Is it like that?
There will be more every year, but the amount produced each year reduces.
Right. It
So it's a
tails off.
decreasing supply every year.
Right, and it converges
Yeah.
at a limit.
Yeah, at a certain time it will be, yeah.
I
Um,
see.
or 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 it will, or it may still continue to grow, but at a lower rate, and the more people come on board, the less of it there'll be to go around, which also increases the value.
Yeah, that makes a bit more sense to me now. So, for example, if I click on one of your posts, does that come? That's my steam going to you, is it? I'm paying you for the like that I've given you.
No, you don't have to. Like, you get a certain amount of, like, I think I've got about 3,000 steam that I have on the platform that I've earned through it. And currently, because the price is pitiful, they're worth about 25 cents each. But at one point, they were worth $8 each. But everything, all of the crypto market is really gone down the pan right now. Until the next time, I think you've posted about on people trading with it, and that, you know, what are they doing actually? Do they know what they're doing at all? But
Yeah, the cycle of speculation kind of thing.
yeah, exactly. Then it's just driven by fear and greed. But what you're looking for is, like, this has got real application because people are actually doing things with it rather than it just being some made up currency. Now Bitcoin has real application, but there's other coins which are really, so many of them are just going to fail because they're just people just thought, oh, I'm going to create a cryptocurrency and try and lure people in, I expect, something like that.
Okay, so if I go to steemit.com,
Yeah,
I can
and again,
put my
Steam it
podcast.
itself isn't, yeah, well, you want to go to Desound.
Desound. Okay.
Desound. But first of all, you need to get into any of the applications on it currently, you need to open a Steam account. And one of the ways is to do it is via steemit.com.
Okay. All right, I'll look into that then. So I'll try and get the podcast on there. I don't see why not.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. And if you d and you're doing quite a few of them, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm doing more than one a day at the moment.
Yeah. So when I was doing my podcast, basically every single one I did, I got to the stage that Desound itself, the actual platform, was giving me a guaranteed upvote worth, at one point, worth about $20 or $30 each time.
Oh,
So it's
right.
all adds up. Yeah,
Yeah, it's
of
worth
course.
having, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Treat it like a savings plan that may or may not come off ultimately. But
Yeah.
if you're already creating the content anyway, you've not got anything to lose.
Ah, that sounds great. Yeah, I'm glad you told me about that. I'll definitely check that out. That's
All
cool.
part of, oh yeah. I mean, I love it. I think I can see so much potential in it. As more and more happens on it, I can just see it's going to really kick off. But
Does it have a phone app as well?
loads of phone apps.
Okay.
There's hundreds of apps being developed on it now. And one thing you can do with it is you can instantaneously transfer money anywhere in the world in 3 seconds,
Right.
with no fee.
Right. Well, like normal currencies or just
No,
Steam?
you have to do it as in Steam, but you can buy Steam.
Yeah.
So long as it's between two Steam accounts, you could buy some Steam, transfer it, and then the next person can take it off.
Got it. Yeah.
So
Okay.
So when people are moaning about bank charges and people are saying TransferWise, which is a great service, very good, but then actually this is, this really, once people start adopting these things and understanding that there's no reason for banks to hold on to your money for 5 days other than them making a profit or whatever and then charge you, I don't know, 30 quid for the privilege of transfer.
Yeah. That's really interesting. Yeah, I'll look into that. Oh, thank you, Sam. That's cool. I enjoyed talking about all that.
Yeah, no, it's good stuff.
Yeah. All right.
Thanks for having me on the show.
Oh, you're welcome. I'll check back in with you soon. Perhaps we'll talk again in a few months or something.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Send me some words with your links and stuff so I can put it on the podcast.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Nice one.
I'll fire that over. All right.
All right,
nice
Sam.
One, Ben.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Cheers. See you. Bye.